I want to take some time today just to do an overview of what are we talking about when we talk about smart and healthy teams and how important that is for your team. And I wanted to share with you an introduction today to the concept of smart and healthy teams and how as a team, when you're smart and healthy, you can create intentional excellence for your organization. That word excellence gets used a lot, I know. But when we add the word intentional to it, it's not something we're just waiting to have happen. It's something that we see as an outcome we are in charge of as a team. And when we bring the smarts together of the team and do the discussion in a healthy way, and we practice healthy and smart practices within our organization, we will actually create intentional excellence that will take us to the next level and give us a competitive advantage. Healthy teams create intentional excellence in these various ways. And I want you to think about how this would apply to your particular organization. Navigating change. How often do you face change? Whether it's through regulatory issues, whether it's through a key player leaving the organization, whether it's through competition in the marketplace or a downturn in the economy, every organization has to navigate change. When that comes to the table, if you haven't been practicing doing things in a smart and healthy way, in the midst of change, in the turmoil and the chaos of that, the team won't suddenly pull together. So we really promote this idea of practicing smart and healthy communication. It's almost like an athlete or a musician that practice so that when they're under the lights, when the pressure's on, they will be able to perform at their best. And the next one is pursuing future opportunities. As a team, if we don't set aside time to talk about what are the future opportunities that this organization may have, we get what I refer to as being heads down. We're so engaged in what we're doing that day in that project that very seldom do we think out of the box or get ahead about what the next opportunity might be. And engaging a team in a smart and healthy way is a great way to find out what those future opportunities through some brainstorming that you might do as a team. And then building a legacy. This idea that as a team, when you're both smart and healthy, you create a culture that goes outside your organization. It goes into families, it goes into communities. When you as a team practice smart and healthy behaviors and practices within your organization, it has a ripple effect to it. And then finally, when we work together as a team, this is where we're going to have the greatest impact. This is where we're going to have the best outcomes. This is where we're going to be able to stretch our goals and reach even further as a team. Only healthy teams can successfully navigate change. They acknowledge the reality. They acknowledge the reality of what they're dealing with in the particular time or issue or the challenges that they're facing. They don't ignore the reality. But here's what's really important. Is they resolve to find solutions. That they have this resolve about them in a healthy team that doesn't give up, that doesn't say, that's not how we do it around here, or we tried that before and it failed, or it's always been this way, it will never change. No, a healthy team, a healthy thinking team, will look at those challenges and say, you know what, we as a team are smart enough to solve this, and we're gonna start working on what our next step might be. I want you to think about this particular quote: when the rate of external change exceeds the rate of internal change, disaster is imminent. Now, this term has been around since the 1940s. It came out of what was called in the economic world as creative disaster. It's the idea that if we keep creating, if we keep expanding, that sooner or later we're going to implode on ourselves. And what happened in the Industrial Revolution of the 1940s is as soon as a factory got set up to do something one way, there was a new version that came out of a particular product, and they would have to shift all their processing and machineries and everything else to produce the new product. Happened again in the 1990s with microchips, when one microchip would come out and then just a few weeks later something would come out faster, and the factories would have to retool to come up with that new microchip. And the idea that we are creating new things all the time, that what happens is it actually destroys itself because we create beyond our ability to keep up with it. So what happens then is if we don't figure out how to keep on our toes internally so that we can change and adapt to the challenges and the opportunities that are around us, then we are not going to keep up. We're particularly not going to keep up with our competition. Here's the analogy. My father-in-law used to love going sailing, and I would go with him down in Tampa Bay, Florida. And we would head out of the St. Petersburg Harbor out towards the Skyway Bridge towards Egmont Key. A beautiful place to go sailing, but the prevailing winds always come up through Tampa Bay. So when you're trying to navigate down to Egmont Key from St. Petersburg Harbor at the pier, you're always facing headwinds, and you would have to do what sailors call tacking. We would have to go back and forth to get to that particular direction. And here's a great sailor proverb, is that you can't control the way the wind is blowing, but you can control how you set your sails. There are things that you can do as a team when you are facing headwinds, when you're trying to get from point A to point B and things are working against you. There are actions that you can take that will continue the momentum as a team. And this is where a team comes in very, very handy. As they start working together, as they start collaborating, as they start brainstorming together, and when they use their various gifts and talents and abilities and perspective, they can find solutions. Here's one of my other favorite quotes that actually comes out of Sweden. There is no such thing as bad weather, only bad clothing. And if you think about the environment that's around us, we don't always have control over the environment, but we can figure out how to put on the right kind of clothing. We can adapt to the change that's around us, and particularly smart and healthy teams learn to do this on a regular basis. They practice it so that when they're under a crisis situation, they can do this well. Smart and healthy teams, They engage, they come together as a team because of the collective smarts, because of the collective talent, because of the collective insight they have, and they do this. They develop the skills. As a team, it's like iron sharpens iron. As you practice this as a team, you just get better and better at this, and you successfully navigate, just like we saw on the sailboat, the team working together. Everybody knows exactly what they need to do and when. And there's this unified, synchronized activity that takes place toward a common goal. And then they create excellence by being intentional. It's not just something that's going to happen by accident. It's not something that we are just hoping for. But as a team, we lay out, and we're going to talk about this a little later in this session, they develop a map of how they're going to get from here to there, very intentionally. They can't get there in all one fell swoop. Just like when I went sailing with my father-in-law, we couldn't just get to Egmont Key without doing some tacking and working the winds. We had to have a plan of how we were going to get from here to there. And then finally, as they get intentional about how they're creating this excellence, they communicate with each other and they work together. There's a sync that happens. There's a synergy that happens as they pull together as a team. I want to talk about this starting point of why. Every organization should be very clear about the why they exist. Why do you do what you do? What's the compelling reason that you came to work this morning? It should be something that excites you. I heard a story years ago about two bricklayers that were out on the sidewalk in the streets of Italy, and as a bypasser walked by, they said, "What are you doing today?" And one man said, "I'm laying bricks." The other guy said, "I'm building a cathedral." Do you have that image? Do you have that vision? Do you have that compelling reason that you are part of something bigger than just yourself and what you might be doing that day? Well, every organization starts out with this mission, vision, and values. And what I want to encourage you to think about as a team is, how do you tell compelling stories, fresh stories, not stories from several years ago, but how do you tell stories from just the past week or two of where you lived out as a team your mission, vision, and values? Do you practice telling those stories? Because those stories become the compelling reason that you want to work together more as a team, that you want to do more together, because you are making a difference in whatever field or industry that you might be in. So as you start developing your mission and vision, this is what happens next. As you start recognizing that you need smart skills, you need to be able to do what you do better. So you go to classes, or you get new technology or new equipment, whatever it might be, so that you become smarter at what you do. And there's this relationship that happens between not only being smart, but doing those things in a way that line up with your mission and vision and support your mission and vision. And as you start developing your skills as an organization and you start working on these skills, now you start seeing what the future opportunities might be. You start looking, this is our mission, this is our vision. We're getting better at what we do, and you get excited about what I refer to as new horizons. It's kind of like in Northeast Tennessee, I love doing hiking, and I'll get out and hike on a trail. And you'll see a ridge coming up ahead, and you can't see much beyond that ridge. But when you get to that ridge, then you can see new horizons of where you can go next. And that happens as a team. As you're working together as a smart and healthy team, you'll have a goal in mind, and when you reach that particular goal, especially as you're developing skills along the way, when you get to that point, now you will see new horizons. You'll see new opportunities, new places that you can reach. But here's the warning, and I want to just take a minute. This is like something that every team needs to pay attention to, because this is the trap. This is what can easily happen. What happens is, as we start becoming smarter at what we do, we start looking at future opportunities based more on what we can accomplish than who we are. That's dangerous. In fact, I see this happen with lots of organizations. And in the nonprofit world that I've dealt with a lot over the years, this particularly happens when a nonprofit might get a grant to do something similar to what they're doing now, but it's not aligned with their core mission, vision, and values. So they may be an organization that does after-school programs for at-risk youth. And they do a great job with that and have done a great job with it for years. And somebody comes along that has a housing grant that will help families get into better housing, and suddenly they say, well, you know what, we have the staff, we have the contacts, we could do this, but it doesn't particularly align with their mission. Before they realize it, they've gotten off in a direction that didn't align with who they were as an organization. They made decisions based on what they could do, forgetting who they are as an organization. So this is how we want to stay away from, as a smart and healthy team, we want to stay away from this whole idea of skewing it off in a different direction with our organization just on what we can do. We have to bring balance to it. And the way we bring balance to it is by recognizing that we need healthy skills, not just smart skills as an organization. That we can align our mission and vision values with future opportunities when we have a balance between smart and healthy skills. So what are healthy skills? Well, part of it is being able to have conflict that is productive and respectful. How do we disagree in a way that gives us a better outcome? How do we resolve conflict when it happens? How do we communicate clearly? How do we not assume that everybody's on the same page? When we've had something that didn't go well, or maybe something that was a success, as a team, do we take the time to come back and evaluate that experience to find out what we can learn from it? Do what I call it quadrant two time, but do we take as a team this time where we set aside, it could be 15, 30 minutes as a team, to talk about what future opportunities might be coming our way, or future threats, could be either one. But do we pause to take the time to get heads up, if you will, and to look out at the horizon and see what's coming, rather than get ourselves caught heads down working on what has to be done? Do we actually take time to work on things that are very, very important but not yet urgent? Because one of the things that you're dealing with every day are these urgent fires that need to be put out. When do you take a pause from that as a team to start looking ahead? That's a healthy practice as a team, and it's what brings balance to setting your future goals and opportunities, because now you stay grounded in who you are, your mission, vision, and values. You're telling compelling stories to each other about what you can accomplish together and reminding each other of why you exist and why you come to work every day. As we go through this, I want to remind us that this idea of creating intentional excellence always begins by engaging, by us coming together as a team. We teach several principles around this, and one of them, and we're going to talk about in a minute, is this idea of a beach ball. But can we come at things from a different perspective? Everybody sees things differently. And when we engage a team in smart and healthy practices, we build trust and respect. The health of the organization is the multiplier of its intelligence. So the healthier you get as a team, the more you gain a competitive advantage against those in the marketplace around you. Patrick Lencioni is one of my favorite authors, and this is a point that he makes as he's working with teams all the time, is we want to become healthier, but what happens is we always seem to lean back over towards the skill side of things, learning how to do new technology or buying a new piece of equipment or going to a particular workshop within our industry, and we just stay busy and busier. And we don't pause to take the time to figure out how are we going to get healthier as a team? How do we engage each other in a healthy way? So here's that principle of the beach ball, the umbrella, and birthday cake is what we refer to this as. The beach ball is simply this principle. If we took a beach ball and set it on the middle of the table and you had your team sitting all around the table, some of the team members would see red, some would see yellow, some would see blue, others might see green. Who's correct? Well, the answer, obviously, all of them are correct. What's different is their perspective. And everybody that's on a team comes to that team with a different perspective. Now, the perspective might be from their background, their experience in life. Some of it comes from their temperament, just how they like to look at things, whether they're a big picture person or a detailed person, whether they are an outgoing person and they verbally process things and they have a lot of people skills, or whether they're somebody that's a little bit more reserved and like to analyze the data. People are going to come at it a lot differently than what you are on your own. And the greatest lesson I believe I've ever learned as a leader is that I'm incomplete. And if I, as a leader, can learn to embrace my incompleteness, to see it as a good thing, to see the fact that I have blind spots, that I am not good at everything, that I can't see every situation from every perspective, then what I have to conclude from that is I need other people to complete me. So it helps me appreciate this team that I put together, this team that I'm engaging, this team that sees things differently than I do. And as a team, we may even debate, we may even argue, we may even have some conflict about whether it's blue or whether it's green or whether it's red or whether it's yellow. But as we listen to each other and we try to understand the other person's perspective, each leader at that table gets a better understanding of the beach ball, a better understanding of the challenge or the opportunity that we might be facing. And here's something to keep in mind. That person that's on the opposite side of the beach ball, they will frustrate you because they are not only seeing things differently than you are, they are seeing things opposite what you may be seeing. They may be making recommendations opposite of what you would make in that particular situation. And it is hard at times to value that person, but they are sitting in the place of what I refer to as my blind spot. They are seeing something about this beach ball, this situation, because of their life experience, because of their temperament and their personality that I would never see. And when they raise that issue, I may or may not agree with them, we may make a decision to go a different way, but it is of great value to hear their perspective on the particular situation. I think about it as I'm driving my car and I go to change lanes and somebody goes, whoa, hang on, there's a car there. And I didn't realize it because the car was in my blind spot. It's something I didn't see coming, but somebody else was able to see that. The next principle we teach is this idea of the umbrella of trust. I think back to the Challenger disaster in Florida back in the late 1980s when NASA was in this race to just have these space shuttles come back and turn them around. I lived in Florida at the time. I lived in St. Petersburg and we were in the flight path for those shuttles landing, and we would hear the sonic boom and we would follow those launches and we would follow the landings and we watch them. And that morning, that January morning when it was about 28 degrees, it was a clear day, I was watching the Challenger launch from St. Petersburg. You could see across the state a couple hundred miles and see that vapor trail go up into the sky on that beautiful blue clear sky that morning. And suddenly that vapor trail went into a Y shape and I knew there was a disaster, something was not right, and ran inside to check the news, and sure enough there had been an explosion and we had lost that crew of the Challenger. In the days and weeks that followed as they began the investigation, they discovered that there were many engineers on the front lines of that project that had great concern about those O-rings on those fuel rockets and launching below a freezing temperature of 32 degrees. And they had written memos, they had gone to their bosses, and those memos sat on desks. And in NASA at that time, there was a top-down command and control style of leadership. And there was not a good flow of information coming from the front line back up into the organization. And if they could have created more of an umbrella of trust, if they had created an environment or a culture to where somebody working that on the front lines could say, hey, I'm not comfortable with this, umbrella of trust, I really want what's best here for everybody, but I want to raise this issue, that they maybe could have gotten some good discussion on the table that could have saved lives that day and maybe even saved that program. So when we work together as a team, there are times that certain people on the team will be reluctant to raise an issue. If you can create an umbrella of trust in that meeting or an umbrella of trust around that meeting to where we get everybody's honest input, about the situation, of what they really believe and feel about it, you will make better decisions as a team. You will also continue to build trust as a team as everyone feels free to honestly express how they're feeling about the decision. The final piece that we want to put in place, and this is called the birthday cake principle. The birthday cake principle is about celebration. Most teams and most organizations that I work with have a hard time doing celebration well. It's hard to take the time to celebrate. It's hard to do celebration well because sometimes we will do celebration in a way that we may give a plaque or an award to one person and five other people on the team are saying, well, why didn't I get one? And their feelings are hurt when we're trying to do something good but actually had a backlash to it. When we celebrate someone's birthday and we present them with a birthday cake, we're not celebrating the candles on the cake. We're celebrating a person. And too often within organizations, it's easy for us to give a plaque that says what we accomplished, so many accident-free days or a certain sales goal. And we'll put that on the plaque and everybody cheers and applauds and that plaque hangs on a wall. And what we just did is we celebrated the candles. We didn't celebrate the person or the people on the team. My youngest son, Brandon, he's in the United States Marine Corps today as an officer and deals with leadership every day. But when he was in high school as a football player, he was the place kicker on his high school football team. And in his junior year, he had a perfect season. He had a season where he made every field goal and every extra point. And at the end of that season, the team had a banquet. And the coach called Brandon up front and he gave him a plaque. And on the plaque it said, congratulations, perfect season. Every field goal, every extra point. The plaque celebrated the candles and not the person or the people on the team. It was after that that Brandon and I sat down one time and at breakfast at Waffle House, because that's what men do. We eat breakfast at Waffle House. And we sat down together and I said to him, I said, did you get that all by yourself? And he paused for a moment and said, no. I said, well, who helped you? And he started naming off the other players that helped him. The first one, Tucker, the young man that was his holder, that was his holder that entire season. Tucker held for every field goal and every extra point, and Brandon and Tucker had the timing down. The next person was the center that snapped the ball to Tucker. Their timing was just immaculate. Then I asked Brandon, I said, okay, how did you get enough time to kick? And he said, well, the special teams line. Those linemen held off the opposing team. Then I asked him, okay, well, how did you get in position on the field to kick an extra point or a field goal? His answer to that was the offense. And then I had one final question. How did the offense get on the field? The answer to that is the defense. And he recognized that at the end of that conversation, that it was the whole team. So I said to him, as you are a leader today, as you are working with men and women who have an accomplishment and you recognize that they couldn't accomplish that all on their own, that it took a team effort, how much difference would it have made to that football team if that coach that day had gotten up and said, Brandon, come on up here. Hey, everybody, Brandon had a perfect season, made every field goal and every extra point. Tucker, would you stand up a minute? Center, would you stand up? The special teams line, would you guys stand up a minute? Because you guys had the timing down. You guys had the protection down where Brandon was able to make those extra points and those field goals. Offense, why don't you stand up, all offensive players. We were able to get the ball into position on the field for an extra point or a field goal. Guys, you were a part of what we did here when we had this perfect season. Then finally, defense, would you stand up? Time and time again, you got the offense on the field so they could get Brandon in position so that the special teams line and the center and the holder could work together with Brandon so he could kick the extra points and the field goals. Guys, do you see what we've done together as a team? It was a team award is what it was. Birthday cakes. Let's celebrate people and not just the accomplishments. There's another great opportunity here with the birthday cake principle as we learn to celebrate well. We begin to build pathways between the accomplishments of the team and the individual contributions. So each person, you can say, this is what you did to help us accomplish this as a team. That pathway also allows you to go back at a later time when they do not do their job well, when they drop the ball, and in a very constructive way can go back to them and say, you know, we really need you to get this report done on time. When you didn't get this report done on time, it affected the rest of the team. So can you please get this done in the future? And it becomes a very natural thing to do, because you've celebrated many times with them about what they did help the rest of the team accomplish their goals together. So the beach ball umbrella and birthday cake principle is one that you want to apply to your team. Here's a question that you must ask at the end of every meeting. Who must do what by when? Do you have a clear understanding of your map and how you get from here to there? Every organization, as you are looking at future opportunities, as you're looking at improving what you do as an organization or as a team, leaders have to first recognize why here is no longer acceptable. Why is here not somewhere we want to stay? Why do we want to go there? Why is there better than here? And our first step with any team, or when we're bringing together an entire company or organization, is to be able to clearly say why here is not acceptable anymore and we need to go there. Maybe it's what you're doing is going to be obsolete in a very short time. I think back on 8-track players. When I think back on companies like Blockbuster that rented out videos, and they were a huge company and never recognized the shift or the change in the demand for their product. They never figured out that here was no longer acceptable, that there was a preferable there in the future. So as a team, that's the first thing we need to do, is why is here not acceptable, and what does the preferred future look like? What does there look like? And then we need to start looking at what are the next steps. Who must do what by when? We're not going to get there in one fell swoop. And going back again to that analogy of the sailboat, anytime you start implementing a change in an organization, anytime you start pursuing a new opportunity, anytime you start figuring out how you're going to avoid a crisis that may be coming down the road or make the changes necessary to survive it, in essence, to put on the right clothing for the bad weather that's coming, you need to have a from here to there map that recognizes that you're going to hit headwinds. And in the sailing analogy, we have to tack there. You want to get from here to there, but you know it's not going to be a straight line. So you're going to start out, and maybe you're going to make progress really, really quick out of the beginning of this as you put your plans together. And suddenly, you're going to hit a hard headwind. Something's not going to go well, or people are going to start complaining. And the next thing you know, you're off track from getting from here to there. And as leaders, you need to figure out, how do we adapt? How do we adjust to get the organization turned back around to get us back on track again? And you're going to find that you're going to have this kind of pattern of up and downs as you're trying to get from here to there, and you don't give up. Because we talked about it earlier, we're going to create intentional excellence. It's not easy. If it was easy, other people would have done it. But this becomes your competitive advantage as a team if you learn to do this well. If you learn to be both smart and healthy, if you make smart decisions but do this in a healthy way, you can navigate the change, you can navigate the headwinds, you can make progress where others won't, and it gives you a competitive advantage as a team. These are simply the questions that you must ask, and it's easy to go through these. I mean, it's just the common questions, but why? Why are we changing? Why are we going to there? Why is here no longer acceptable? As leaders, we need to be able to answer the why question, and we need to answer it first with our team so that we start getting their buy-in. Then we say who. Who's going to do what? Who must do what by when? Who do we need to communicate to? Who do we need to get buy-in from? Who will this serve better? And we start asking the who questions as a team. Then simply what? What is it that needs to be done today? What is it that is going to be the preferred future? What are we going to be able to accomplish together? What is the big idea? What is the big goal of what we're going towards here? When? When do we get started, and when might we reach this? Every map that you're designing here must have a time frame to it. How long is this going to take? So we ask the question, when? Is it a 6-month project, a 1-year, a 2-year project? How long is it? And then we start figuring out what the incremental steps might be. And where? Where are we going? And we need to describe that in a compelling way. We need to be able to talk about what that preferred future would look like if everything was perfect. In fact, Vince Lombardi used to have this saying where if you shoot for perfection, you will hit excellence. And there's a point here where we need to look at what the preferred future would look like if it was perfect. And let's start aligning ourselves and working towards that. And in the goal of being perfect, we will hit excellence in what we do. We may not get it all done, but we certainly will try to get close with that. And then how are we going to do this? What's it going to take? And the how question is the question that we need to ask last, because we need to know what the next step is. How are we going to take the next step? How are the steps going to go together to get us from here to there? And the buy-in is huge in this process. And one of the principles that I teach is that we need what I call buy-in by permission. John Maxwell, in his book, The Five Levels of Leadership, talks about the first level is the level of position. You're given a position of leadership. The second level is the level of permission. And the question there is, do you have the permission of those you are leading for you to lead them? Because you're not leading them anywhere until they really give you their permission, because that's their point of buy-in. And too often when we take a team or a group or an organization or a group of donors or customers or clients and we start moving them in a direction, we don't take the time to get buy-in by permission. Many times we'll get the buy-in politically by pressure. We'll get it in by some sort of reward system to where temporarily they'll buy in to what we're doing. Sometimes we get their buy-in from overselling or overpromising. But it's so important that as a team and as an organization, we get buy-in by permission, that we actually get their permission to take them from here to there, that they trust us with this, that they respect us, that they've bought into the idea and the plan that here is no longer acceptable and that there is going to be our preferred future and that the journey in between is going to be difficult, but it will be worth it when we get there. That's how we get their buy-in by permission. So as we go through these particular principles and we start thinking about the idea of a healthy team, a team that's smart, a team that has collective skills and knowledge and gifts and abilities, but a team that as they come together in a healthy way, multiply their intelligence by being healthy as a team. That as a team, you start telling stories about your mission, your vision, your values. You look at future opportunities based more on who you are than just what you can do. And as you develop those smart skills of what you can do in a way that is healthy, to where you build trust and respect for each other, and you start moving together in synergy, in unity, you start recognizing the beach ball principle of understanding each other's perspectives and valuing the different people that are on your team. You have an umbrella of trust where you can raise concerns or ideas freely within the organization, and that you celebrate your accomplishments together, not just for what you did, but for who accomplished it and the people on your team, and that you hold each other accountable in that process. Now you have a team that's not just smart, but it's smart and healthy. A team that's moving together to create intentional excellence.